This is the start of the rest of your life. This is the moment where love and truth collide. Your eyes open, wide, wide open. This is a love song he's singing over you. Through all the chaos, his hand is reaching through, pulling you closer. It's not over. This is just the beginning. This is love, this is the journey. So keep running, it's a brand new day. Reach out and grab it, you've been raised up from the ashes. This is the start of the rest of your life. This is your story. He's faithful every word. I see redemption with every page that turns. It's not over, no, it's not over. This is just the beginning. This is love, this is a journey. So keep running, it's a brand new day. Reach out and grab it, you've been raised. Up from the ashes, this is the start of the rest of your life. Leave your past behind you. Every stain is washed away. It's a brand new day. This is just the beginning. This is love. This is the journey. So keep running, oh, keep running. It's a brand new day. Reach out and grab it. You've been raised up from the ashes. This is the start of the rest of your life. Oh, this is the start of the rest of your life.
We need to have rhythms in our lives where we get away from the busyness and we get away from the crowds and we get alone with God.
If Jesus acknowledged his need for time alone with God, we surely benefit from following his example.
It's important for us to learn to tune into his voice because there are a lot of voices that we can listen to.
He holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong. Living truth.
We live in a society that places constant demands on our time. And in fact, busyness has become a status symbol of sorts. By being a busy person, we're perceived as important and successful. But what is the cost of our frenzied pace? In today's message, Brett McBride encourages us to seek times of solitude with God, to follow the example set by Jesus himself when he went to a solitary place to pray. This is Living Truth.
Good morning. Happy New Year. You can turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. What better way to enter into a new year, a new season, and at the outset of that year, have your eyes fixed on the author and perfecter of our faith, asking him to lead and direct our church in this new year. As we are heading into a week of prayer, I want to take this morning to review why we do this as a church, and I trust that today's text will illustrate the importance of setting time aside to get alone with God and do business with God, to be with him in prayer, and why it's essential for us in the midst of our busy world that we live in here in Toronto. It was estimated in 1967 that the average American's work week, by the time it reached our generation, would be approximately 22 hours long if you worked full-time because of all the industrial efficiencies that they were coming up with in 1967. As computers continued to accelerate productivity, they thought people will have all kinds of leisure time on their hands because they'll only be required to work 22 hours when engaged in full-time employment. Now, I would be hard-pressed to find anyone who's employed full-time and only puts in 22 hours at their employer's expense. Maybe a pastor because they only work one day a week anyways, but beyond that, and there's few people in our congregation that you could approach and say, oh, you're employed full-time and you only work 22 hours. No, the Statistics Canada says the average Canadian works 36.6 hours, but I would guesstimate in our congregation, it's probably closer to 50 to 60 hours a week. And beyond our work lives, there's all kinds of demands on our time. If you have children, certainly you're dropping the kids off at school or daycare and picking them up, sports teams, after school activities, play dates with friends. Lives can become very busy very quickly. In a recent study, children were asked, if there was anything that you could change about your parents' work, what would it be? And to their surprise, kids weren't asking for more FaceTime with their parents. There might be reasons for that. But what they were saying is that I wish my parents' job was less stressful. And so in the busyness and in the stress that comes into our lives, researchers are finding that it's affecting the children within the family structure. Research indicates that commuters experience greater levels of stress than fighter pilots and riot police. So that's not good news if you're living in the city of Toronto.
No,
it's not. Commuters experience greater levels of stress than fighter pilots or riot police. Now, someone suggested to me after I said that in first service that fighter pilots and riot police get to release their stress. Don't do that in traffic. But there is a constant demand on our time, and in the busyness of life, are we taking time and setting it aside to get alone with God so that when we're surrounded by the crowds, we're aligned with His purposes? That's what I want to look at this morning. And in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, we read this. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where He prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else to the nearby villages so I can preach there also. That is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. What I want to look at this morning is two things: the prayerful person and the preoccupied person. Previous to the verses we just read, Jesus has entered into his public ministry for about a year and a half now. He's called together his group of disciples. He's walked up to Peter and Andrew, James and John at the Sea of Galilee and said to them, "Follow me and I will make you into fishers of men." So this is pretty early on into them being shaped into fishers of men. And Jesus, once they are following him, preaches at a synagogue in Capernaum. And during his message on the Sabbath, while he's preaching, a demon-possessed man cries out in the middle of his message. And Jesus casts out the demon in the synagogue in Capernaum. After service is over, Jesus goes to Peter's house. And Peter's mother-in-law is sick with a fever. Jesus heals her, and she begins to serve them Sunday brunch or dinner. And we're told in Mark's gospel that once the sun sets and Sabbath is over, the whole town of Capernaum shows up at Peter's house looking for Jesus because they witnessed what Jesus did in the synagogue on the Sabbath. And they show up with family members or friends who are sick with various diseases, and we're told in Mark chapter 1 that Jesus, late into the night, is healing all who are sick with various diseases and casting out demons. So Jesus has come off an evening of intense ministry where he taught in the synagogue, where he engaged in spiritual warfare, where he healed and conducted ministry late into the evening. But we're told in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, very early in the morning, in fact, while it was still dark, Jesus gets up, leaves the house, goes off to a solitary place where he prays. Nobody could have argued with Jesus to maybe hit the snooze alarm, kill the rooster that's crowing at daybreak. But Jesus places such importance on his alignment with the Father, Jesus displaying that he is fully human and dependent on his Father, gets up while it's still dark outside after a late night of overtime ministry and goes off to be alone in solitude with the Father where he prays. Oftentimes you see in the Gospels, Jesus leaving the crowds and going to a solitary place to be with the Father. Here in Mark 1:35, the Greek word for solitary place is the word eremos. It means a desolate wilderness, a lonely place, an out-of-the-way place. Jesus places such an importance and emphasis on prayer, and early on into the disciples' ministry life where they're being taught to be fishers of men, Jesus displays for them that your prayer time, that your solitary place, that getting away with God in the eremos, in the wilderness, being alone with him, has such high importance that even when you've done a busy day of ministry, you need to get alone and be with God before the crowd comes pressing in. And so Jesus goes to an out-of-the-way place, and he reveals to us early on in his ministry that we need times of solitude and prayer in our lives in the secret place. It is there that we meet with God and are aligned with his purposes. There's only one instance in all of the Gospels where the disciples walk up to Jesus and ask him to explicitly teach them about something, and it is when they walk up to him and say, "Teach us, Lord, how to pray." I think they looked at Jesus's life and they didn't ask, "Teach us, Lord, how to do awesome miracles. Teach us, Lord, how to preach." They said, "Teach us, Lord, how to pray." What does that tell you about the importance of our prayer life? Jesus, when teaching his disciples about prayer in Matthew chapter 6 during the Sermon on the Mount, shares with them this verse about prayer, "But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." And Jesus basically says to them, you need to go to the eremos. You need to go into solitude, get alone with God. That might be the room in your house or a closet in your house or some place where you can be alone and pray, and your Father who sees what is done in the secret place will reward you. There is a reward when we take time to be alone with the Father, where we intentionally carve out time out of the busy schedules that we all have to commune with our Heavenly Father. Henry Nouwen, speaking about the importance of solitude, says this, "Without solitude, it is virtually impossible to live a spiritual life. We do not take the spiritual life seriously if we do not set aside some time to be with God and listen to him." Years ago, when I was studying at Tyndale Bible College, I took a course that was on the spiritual disciplines. And I remember being exposed to the discipline of solitude and the importance of getting away with God alone. So I thought it would be a good idea to put into practice what I was learning in school. And I decided to go camping completely alone. I had never camped all by myself prior to this. And so I thought, I'll go during the weekdays when campgrounds are quieter. It was late September, so it was getting cooler at night. There weren't as many mosquitoes. And I packed up all my camping gear and went up to Kilbear Provincial Park, just north of Parry Sound. And when I checked in at the park gate and with the park ranger, I think there might have been one or two other people in all of the campground, and it's a massive campground. So I had the pick of sites. I picked a nice location right where I was staring out over the water and just beautiful rock faces surrounded by God's creation. And I thought, this is awesome. It's just so wonderful to be in solitude with God alone. I experience him through his creation. I can stare at a loon on the water, just glistening over the water, and when it does its little thing, I'm just in awe of the God who created it all. So I'm out there all by myself and just enjoying time alone, and there's no one in sight. The other two people, I think, that were at Kildare Provincial Park were about a mile away from me, so you didn't see anyone. And I'm enjoying my campfire. I just finished cooking my dinner, and as I'm settling down in my camping chair and I've finished dinner, I'm sitting there with the coffee, staring out over this beautiful scene. The sun goes down, and then the darkness starts to set in. And as the darkness set in, all of a sudden, what I remember is when I pulled up at the front gate to Kildare Provincial Park, there was a cooler that they had out on display to remind people that you should always pack your food away because there are bears at Kildare Provincial Park. And this cooler had been mauled by a bear. So there's these huge claw marks on this cooler. And as it's getting darker and darker, I'm thinking about that cooler. And then I'm looking at my campsite, and I wasn't the most experienced outdoorsman. There's food everywhere all over my campsite, open food. And as I'm drinking my drink and staring out at the lake and it's dark, I'm starting to get really afraid. And I'm thinking to myself, this solitude thing isn't very much fun. Somehow I would feel a lot more comforted if there was a couple of my buddies here, because if a bear comes along, I'm in big trouble. As I'm thinking these thoughts, and it's dark now, it's pitch black, you can't see anything. My fire wasn't the greatest fire. Like I said, I wasn't the most experienced outdoorsman. And so it wasn't giving enough light to see much beyond the picnic table that was on my site. And as I'm sitting there, all of a sudden I hear a loud twig crack. And then I hear another twig crack, and I'm hearing more and more twigs crack. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, that's great, I'm gonna die in solitude. Certainly a bear is gonna come out of the woods and maul me like I'm a cooler. So as I'm sitting there and I'm hearing the cracking twigs get closer and closer to my campground, I reach for my flashlight and I click it and I turn around quickly, and what's in the light of my flashlight are these two black eyes staring back at me. And it was the cutest little raccoon you've ever seen in your life. In fact, lots of eyes were reflecting back to me as the raccoons descended on my campground looking for the scraps of food that I had left around my campsite. Like I said, there wasn't many other people up at Kildare Provincial Park, so word got out quickly that my campground was the place to be. On another trip later, I discovered that raccoons can actually open your tent and get inside. So be careful when you go camping. You actually have to take your shoe and tie your zippers together so that they don't open them, because they will come into your tent in the middle of the night. I was smart enough to leave my food in the car through the night so that no bears came. But I remember, as much as I was afraid when I was alone, it was profound to be away from all other people and be in a solitary, out-of-the-way place where you're alone with God. After about 36 hours, I needed more firewood, and I went to get some from the local store just outside the park gate, and I hadn't spoken in 36 hours. I was just sitting quietly with my thoughts, and I remember how strange it was when my voice came out and I had to say some words to people, because I hadn't heard my own voice in 36 hours. I hadn't engaged in human dialogue for that long, and that's not an extended, really long time, but it was enough for me to hear my own voice and just go, oh, wait, yeah, I can talk and I can commune. So it was a beautiful moment to be alone. And we need to have rhythms in our lives where we get away from the busyness and we get away from the crowds and we get alone with God. It's wise for us to have this daily, getting up early, or if you're a night person, in the evening, and being alone with God so that we can be aligned with his purposes for our lives. And God invites us into solitude to be alone with him. And weekly, we should have a Sabbath day, a daily practice where we're in our quiet times with God. For me, that's the Scarborough Bluffs. And that's a place where I can walk the new addition to my family, our dog. I walk my dog down there. And it's a beautiful place to pray because you can be utterly alone with God, staring at the vastness of his creation and just speak to him and open up before him. And this is the beauty and the mystery of prayer. God invites us into solitude. He wants us to go into the secret place so that we may commune with him. Isn't that amazing? The God who spoke all of creation into existence invites you to be alone with him. And if you study scripture, you see a common denominator in the lives of the saints throughout scripture that they carve out time to be alone with God. Abraham throughout scripture is building altars of worship to God. Jacob wrestles with the angel when he's alone. Moses daily is going out to the tent of meeting where he speaks with God face to face as someone speaks to a friend, we're told. Daniel, three times a day, even in the busyness of being an administrator within the Babylon nation, high-ranking person within Babylon, prioritized prayer and observed it three times daily, even with his busy schedule. We're told in the Gospels that the prophetess Anna, in the New Testament, in the Gospels, when Jesus is brought to the temple to be presented at the temple, she was described as never leaving the temple, praying night and day, fasting and praying. Jesus, coming off of a busy evening of ministry, a busy day of ministry, gets up early, gets alone with God so that his heart and his life may be aligned with God's purposes for that day. If Jesus is doing it, how much more do we need to be doing it? We all need an eremos, a secret place where we get alone with God. And can I suggest that we need to build this as a rhythm in our lives? We need to be intentional about scheduling those times to be alone with God until it becomes a habit within our lives. If we just wait for the moments where we feel like praying, I've discovered in my life experience, and I don't think it's unique to me, that if you just wait until you feel like it, the day, the weeks, the months will go by, and you won't be spending quality time with God. Other things will crowd into your life and eat up that space. But we also need to look at the quality of our quiet time with God. It's not enough just to get alone with him. We also need to look at the level of intimacy that we engage when we're in the times of solitude. What I'm about to share is a framework for levels of conversation. It's not the most comprehensive, but can I suggest to you that in any human relationship, there are four levels of conversation. There's first the casual conversation. This is what we all engage with, oftentimes with strangers. When you meet someone at the grocery store, you might know them nominally. They might be an acquaintance. But it's just casual conversation that you're engaging in about the weather, about what's going on in society. The next level of conversation is information. This is where you're sharing about what you're doing that day. You're just exchanging information about what's on your agenda or what you've got going on in life. The next layer of conversation is the area of our feelings, where we're expressing our emotions to one another and how we're really doing deep down. And the most intimate place of our lives is the secret place. The place where our soul resides, our deepest fears are felt, our insecurities, our desires, the things we don't want others to know about or see are within the secret place. When I first got married, it started to dawn on me the different levels of communication that my wife and I would engage in. The male species, in my opinion, this is just my opinion, it's not fact, but I've lived a while. I've seen the male species in action. I play hockey every Friday night, me and my hockey mates. I've field tested this. I've done it with a focus group. The male species is very strong at casual conversation. We can have casual conversation for a lifetime and not miss it. We can get together with the same guys every week, be best friends, and not share about our feelings. We could talk about the weather, we can talk about politics, we can have playful banter with one another. And so when I first got married, I would come home from my day at work and my wife, Stephanie, would ask me, how was your day? And I would say, good. And that told her everything she needed to know. And then I would ask her, how was your day? And she would go, oh, it was wonderful. I met with Joanne and her kids are doing great at school, but she's having a bit of trouble here and she's got feelings and da-da-da-da. And like an hour later, I would have the most comprehensive understanding of the details and the emotions that she went through that day. See, my wife could go straight to the feelings, oftentimes to the secret place, 0 to 100 in a heartbeat. And I had to learn that my wife wanted more detail than good. I had to learn what it was to share detailed information with her, let alone my feelings and even maybe some of my insecurities. One of the biggest challenges I see with men in Christianity is that we don't have deep, meaningful relationships with one another where we go to the secret place. Can I suggest to you that if you are resonating with what I'm saying, if you are a male Christian in this room and you can't count any relationships or friendships that you have that actually go to the secret place, you need to deal with that this year. You need to have a few brothers that you can share the most intimate parts of your life with. Yes, if you're in a relationship, that can be your significant other. But I would also suggest that you need some other brothers to go there with. If you are a female Christian, I would suggest the same, but oftentimes I've observed that the female species can go to the secret place with one another, sometimes even with complete strangers, in a matter of minutes. And that is an absolute strength that the male needs to learn to cultivate in their life. But if these are the four levels of conversation, what I've also noticed in my own life is that there are four levels of prayer. There are times that you can go to a place of solitude, you can go to the secret place, but you're not going to share any secrets with God. You're going to go to the secret place and you're going to pray a prayer that sounds like the same prayer every day. It's just a machine gun on repeat. And you're not actually getting intimate with God. You're not allowing your feelings to be expressed to Him. Some people do that verbally. Others do it when they journal. But are you going deep into prayer where you allow God to speak into the very core of who you are? Are you acknowledging where you're at with God? And so we can walk into church and someone can ask us, how are you doing? And oftentimes what you'll hear is, good. Meanwhile, your marriage might be in crisis. Your prodigal children are causing pain to your heart. Work isn't going so well. You might have lost your job. Things aren't good at all. But we put on the happy, smiley face where we go, good. And deep inside, we're hurting. God invites us into times of solitude to get alone with Him so that what is going on deep inside of us can be unearthed. He already knows what's going on inside. He just wants us to acknowledge it before Him so that we can talk about it. But if we hold on to it, if we bury it, if we think that we can somehow fool Him that it's not good, we're only kidding ourselves. So we need to learn to share our feelings and go to the secret place. That's why I love reading the Psalms of David. David communicates every emotion before God. He is just an open book before his God. And what is he described in Scripture as? A man after God's own heart. And so it's not just enough that we get alone with God. We have to allow Him into the deep places of our lives so that we're aligned with His purposes and not just coasting along in life. Again, Henry Nouwen says this about entering into solitude. We enter into solitude First of all, to meet with our Lord and to be with Him and Him alone. Only in the context of grace can we face our sin. So we are invited into this one-on-one time with grace. And only in the place of healing do we dare show our wounds. Only with a single-minded attention to Christ can we give up our clinging fears and face our own true nature. Solitude is a place where Christ remodels us in His own image and frees us from the victimizing compulsions of the world. We need to step off the treadmill of life and the busyness that we are engaged in and be alone with Him. And Jesus models in the Gospels getting up early to be alone with the Father, even on the heels of a busy day of ministry, to pray. Peter and the disciples also get up, but contrasted with Jesus, they get up and get busy. And you can see that Peter and the disciples are the preoccupied person. Jesus is communing with the Father. And Peter and his companions, we're told in Mark 1, verse 36, Simon and his companions went to look for him. And when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." In other translations, it describes Peter and his companions searching anxiously for Jesus. The RSV says, hunting for him. I imagine that Peter and his group of other disciples show up and say, "Jesus, where have you been? We've been looking all over for you. There's a huge crowd in Capernaum. They saw what you did yesterday, and we've got a revival on our hands." See, Peter's busy planning Jesus' next steps for him. Peter shows up and he says, "We've got a revival on our hands. We could set up a tent. We can have revival meetings. This is great. Everybody's going to know you're the Messiah. Come on, Jesus, let's just, we've been looking all over for you. Where have you been?" Who can blame Peter? If a crowd showed up at any one of our doors and they were looking for Jesus, we would probably do the same thing, wouldn't we? And if all of a sudden the city of Toronto was pounding on the doors of the People's Church asking for Jesus and he was around physically, we would probably go look for him. And so Peter and his companions feel the pressure of the crowd that are hunting for Jesus, and they're on a quest to find him so that he can accommodate their demands. We might be well-intentioned in our plans, but if we haven't prioritized solitude with God, we can be busy, busy, busy with all kinds of good things. They might be right things, but they're not God's things. And there's a danger for that in our lives. We can get so focused on good things like ministry, we can get so focused on the work of the Lord that we forget to focus on the Lord of the work. And there is a huge, huge difference there. For 16 years, I served in urban ministry in hurting communities. And I saw all kinds of lives burn out because people wanted to respond to the needs of the crowd all the time. When you're serving in a community that has a lot of need and a lot of pain, the danger is that a Messiah complex can actually set in, and you think you need to be omnipresent and available to everybody's needs and desires because that's the Christian thing to do, isn't it? And the danger is you can get into a pace of activity, and it might be good things that you're doing, but the strength of Christ is no longer fueling your ministry. It's you doing it in your own strength. Jesus gets alone with God because he's dependent on the Father to direct his path. Jesus gets alone with God because he said in the Gospel of John, "I can only do what I see the Father doing. I only speak what the Father tells me to speak." And that was connected to his alone time with God. But we can get caught up planning all kinds of activity, and God's not in it. And there's warning signs that set into our lives where we're drifting from these times of solitude. Irritability can set in. There's a loss of joy that we have for the ministry that we're serving in, a loss of connectivity if we're honest with God. We can have compassion fatigue start to set in. And if we don't get alone with God, if we're always present to the needs of the crowd, eventually we burn out. And Peter's busy with the crowd. He feels the pressure of the crowd. And because he hasn't prioritized solitude alone with the Father, he's anxiously searching for Jesus, but he's driven by the needs of the crowd. And they're feeling the pressure of this crowd and are busy trying to make plans for Jesus. And Jesus contrasts it with being alone in the eremos, the silent place, the solitary place. And when Peter shows up, anxiously searching for him, finally finding him, and Peter says, "Where have you been? Everybody's looking for you." Jesus replies and says to him, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. That's why I've come." That probably caught Peter and his disciples off guard. Here, a seeming revival has broken out. Crowds are thronging to see Jesus and meet Jesus. And Jesus, after consulting the Father, is given a completely different agenda. No, I must leave the crowd and go to those who haven't heard about the kingdom yet. You read through the rest of Mark's gospel, Jesus is led by God to leave the crowd and go to a leper. How counterintuitive is that to us? We would see the crowd and try and minister to their needs, and God's directive for the Messiah is to go and spread the message to those who weren't there yet, to go to a leper who couldn't even enter into the crowd. So the reason it's so important for us to be on our knees praying as a church is because we need to be so aligned with the heart of the Father that we are going to reach out for the people and stepping into the good works that he's prepared in advance for us to do. And can I suggest that we won't know what those good works are until we've spent alone time with him in solitude? See, the results of our prayer times often don't show up during the prayer time. They show up later in the day when we run into that scenario that the prayer time prepared us for. Prayer establishes God's priorities for our lives. Prayer prepares us to minister to the people we're going to be engaged with. But prayer frustrates our predisposed plans if we come with an idea of how Jesus should minister to the crowd. I'm sure that Peter and his disciples were probably stunned when Jesus, when presented with Peter's plans, says, "No, we need to go this way, Peter. You're on the exact opposite page." Actually, in Luke's account of this event, in Luke 4:42, we read that Peter and his companions tried to stop Jesus from leaving that region. So you can see that Peter and his companions had a predisposed idea of how Jesus should move, but they hadn't spent time in the eremos. They hadn't spent time in the secret place seeking the Father's will. Let me close with this. Church, we are entering into a week of prayer. We as a body collectively want to acknowledge our complete dependence on our Heavenly Father. And we as a church are praying and seeking and asking God, what is it, Lord, that you would have us do in our generation, in our day and age? What are the good works that you've prepared in advance for us to walk in 2017 and beyond? And what better way to enter into 2017 than on your knees asking God, what is it you would have us do? On our face before him, praying for him to align us with his purposes, to align us with his priorities. And sometimes that is preaching to the crowd and ministering to the needs of many. Other times it's leaving the crowd and going to the leper. How will we know unless we're on our knees praying? And so what I'm asking for us to do as a church family, as we enter into a new year, is pray, church. Get alone with God this week. Pray on behalf of the church. Pray that God would reveal to you what is my part within your plans for me individually and for us corporately as a church. Pray that we might be shaped into the church that God wants us to be in this day, in this generation, in this city, in this region, and that we would be captivated by His vision and His purposes and His agenda for our lives. We're not going to go away and make plans and ask God to bless them. We're going to get on our knees and ask God to inform us as to what His plans are, where He is active, so that we may join Him in His activities that He's already prepared in advance for us to walk in. Sound like a plan? So my one request this week, and as we enter into this month and this new year, is that we as a church would pray, and on Friday night, when we come together, we will raise our collective voices to Him, seeking what He would have us do as a church, who we would be as a church, and His purposes and His priorities for why He's planted us as a church where we are. Let's close with prayer. Father, we thank You for Your word. We thank You for the reminder at the beginning of a new year. We need to be in this place of solitude with You. Lord, I pray that this would work its way into all of our lives, that each of us would place a priority on being alone with You. And Lord, may we be intimate before You. May we allow You to move in the deep places of our lives, in the secret place. Lord, may we experience a year of prayer where we are shaped from the inside out by Your gentle hand at work. Invite us by Your grace into this time. We thank You for Your word and how it encourages us. And we acknowledge at the outset of 2017 that we are completely dependent on You and Your priorities and Your purposes for us as a church. Give us ears to hear them. Give us hearts and minds that are alert to what You're doing. Give us eyes to see it. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The disciples spent a great deal of time with Jesus. They listened to Him teach. They saw Him perform miracles. They listened to His conversations and shared meals together. They acknowledged and sometimes addressed Him as teacher. How interesting then that the one thing the disciples explicitly asked Jesus to teach them was how to pray. According to an article I read recently, one of the signs that your life is too busy is that everything feels important. When we have so much to do, we can become reactive rather than proactive, simply running around putting out fires rather than taking time to plan and prioritize. Unfortunately, when we do this, many of the truly important things don't get the attention they deserve. Do either of you struggle with this issue we call busyness?
I think we're all guilty of it, but I would say that we're all trying very hard to stay very rooted in our personal relationships with God. And in fact, this is something I journaled about a few weeks ago, just personally as a mom. You know, I have young kids, I'm really busy with ministry and with their, you know, schedules, that it's really easy to go on autopilot and just let the busyness direct our lives. And God was saying to me, you know, you got to check in with me because I'm your parenting coach. I'm your the one who's going to give you the big picture. And I want to be an intentional parent. I don't want to just follow what everyone else is doing. So I want to hear, oh, what are the things I need to do to encourage my son? What does my daughter need right now? And God knows more than I do. So I'm quite committed to that time to journal and hear from God personally.
It's so true what Lily is saying. And certainly it's true for us here at the People's Church. We're a very, very busy spot, very busy community. But I think this idea, this challenge is true for everyone in our culture. Really, we live in a very busy world, And that doesn't seem to be getting less in spite of our advanced technology. Right. It seems to be that that's adding to the problem, if at all. So it's so, so important to take that time with the Lord. One of my best reads is biographies. Mm-hmm. So I've read William Tyndale, William Booth, William Wilberforce, John Wesley. And if there's one thing that is common for these men of God, and also Amy Carmichael, to throw in a woman, it's that they had this discipline. That's a common element, as you see. They spent time alone with the Lord. And these names that I just gave you, they span a number of different ages. But the fact of the matter is, no matter where we are or what age we're living in, there are demands on our time. Mm-hmm. And if we don't follow Jesus' example, get alone with the Lord, then life can just crowd in on us so that we don't have the time. And moreover, we're less efficient in the time that we do have. So to me, it's something that is so fundamental to the Christian walk. And if you're missing this, you're missing so much. And we all can have excuses. I mean, there's no one more busy than a young mom. But you could look at any particular vocation, any particular profession, any particular family that is trying to make it in our busy world. The need is there to find the time alone. So I guess the challenge is, how do you discipline yourself? How do you employ that discipline in your own circumstance? That's the challenge.
What does solitary prayer look like for you? Is there a certain time of day? Is it every day? Is it a kind of a weekly thing? Is there a place you go? Are there practices that you do? So anything that you're kind of willing to share from your experience, I think is helpful, because I know it's going to be different for different people, but sometimes we can get ideas from how other people do it.
Well, I start with a sip of coffee, and then I read the Bible.
Okay.
So there's that entering into His presence, being washed by His Word, and then I will often first speak to Him in my journaling, and then I listen for what He has to say. And part of, I think, our spending time with God is, it's important for us to learn to tune into His voice, because there are a lot of voices that we can listen to, voices that have been embedded into us through our culture, our parents, our third grade teacher, and the enemy is also trying to get our attention at this very same time. This is a spiritual battle, and when people are trying to differentiate, oh, is this from God, is this not from God, I tell them to look at the fruits of the Spirit as well as 1 Corinthians 13, love is, because God is love. But if God is love, then one would think that His voice would be loving, would sound like the fruits of the Spirit. And so that's how I ask people, when they do start to hear from God and they're just trying to develop that muscle, they can line it up with those scriptures, and then always to seek counsel from Christians who are a little bit ahead in the journey to say, hey, this is what I'm hearing. What do you think? Does this sound like it's coming from God?
The way I organize or try to ordain my day is to start at the beginning of the day with scripture reading. I have two or three devotionals that come into my inbox overnight, so and they're usually good quality devotionals. Then I spend a little bit of time in the Word of God.
I've been actually teaching my four-year-old to do this. At the end of our days, we'll pray, you know, and we'll pray what we're grateful for, what happened during the day, who we're going to pray for. But at the end of the prayer, I'll say, okay, now we're going to sit in silence and we're going to ask Jesus what He has to say to us tonight.
Wow.
And a few weeks ago, my four-year-old son said to me after this period of silence, he said, Jesus said, my heart is in your heart.
Wow.
And I thought, that's the Holy Spirit.
Wow.
So it's really an amazing practice, and I want him to know His voice now in the simple and little things in life, so that when life gets more complicated, he will be used to hearing from Jesus.
I really appreciate how your examples are different, because I think there's just different stages of life. There's different personality types out there, and it's important for people to understand there isn't one way. It is a relationship, right? Our times with God can look different also.
But if you understand the importance of welcoming the presence and power of Christ and His omniscience to be at work in and through you, then He gives you the word. And I've been astounded at how people have come back to me and said, your prayer was bang on. And it wasn't because of who I am or my particular insights. It's because of that dynamic, the Holy Spirit ministering through me. I need to make sure that I have my life wide open to that resource at all times.
Yeah. And Lily?
When I'm rooted in God's love and His presence, I'm not striving to prove my value. I'm not spinning my wheels trying to achieve things. Instead, I'm moving with directed purpose, and I know that God is carrying the steps. So the weight of the responsibilities that I carry are much lighter when I'm rooted in that solitude with Him. But it is the sweetest thing to spend time with Jesus, to receive from Him supernatural love and wisdom. Especially if you're working in ministry, you're trying to give away God's love, but you can't give away what you haven't received. And so you have to make time to just receive it. And it's so good. It really is.
The remarkable thing about this is God's invitation to us. It's the Lord's invitation to us. Come into the secret place. Be alone with me. You know, that very invitation itself, I think, underlines the importance of it. It's important to Him to be with us.
God already knows what's going on in our lives and in our hearts at any given moment. And yet, He invites us to spend time alone with Him. We may encounter some resistance internally and externally because our culture is afraid of silence. But it's worth the initial discomfort for the reward of knowing Him and of being fully known. And I think you guys have explained that with me.
This spring, join Living Truth as we travel by luxury coach to beautiful Lancaster, Pennsylvania. From May 14th to 17th, your wonderful adventure includes a guided sightseeing tour through Amish country, a steam train ride, a visit to historical Hershey, Pennsylvania, and more. Your visit to Lancaster also includes a live performance of the greatest story of all time, Jesus, at the renowned Sight and Sound Theater. Experience the journey alongside the most important person to ever walk the earth and the everyday people whose lives He transformed forever. You'll also enjoy 3 nights at the beautiful Eden Resort Hotel. For details, visit online at myawakenedjourney.com or call 1-877-465-3442. Be a part of this wonderful Living Truth experience and have a great time of spiritual refreshing and Christ-centered fellowship. See you in Lancaster, May 14 to 17.
Time alone with God in prayer helps us establish His priorities for our lives. Jesus, after spending time with His Father, left the crowd that had gathered to go minister to a leper. He consistently demonstrated that He was dependent on the Father to direct His path, rather than always responding to the needs and requests of the people. If Jesus acknowledged His need for time alone with God, we surely benefit from following His example. Join us next time for more clear biblical teaching here on Living Truth.
To watch this message again, visit our website, download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube. Join us next week for a 3-part encore series from Charles Price called Becoming Fishers of Men.
my side when I hear the thunder roll. Well, he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong.
Sing it again.
Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. Well, he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong.
Jesus is a fence around his children. His grace is sufficient to stand the storm. His word is a promise we can stand on. When the winds of this world are blowing strong.
Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. Well, he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong.
Break it down. Come on.
Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. Well, he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong. Well, Jesus is with me when the storm clouds gather. He's standing by my side when I hear the thunder roll. Well, he holds my hand when I begin to tremble, when the winds of this world are blowing strong. When the winds of this world are blowing strong. When the winds of this world are blowing strong.